Right, so one always wonders what is the use of calculating drag forces and lift forces on hypersonic vehicles at high Mach numbers. So for instance, one important example is found in during reentry. So during reentry, for instance, in a ballistic reentry like this, the spacecraft is approaching in along an orbit or an orbital trajectory, and then it's going to reenter. And during the reentry, the trajectory is going to get deflected, and it's going to get deflected not only because of the presence of the atmosphere, even if it was ballistic, but also because many of these re-entry vehicles, they have lifting capabilities. Even this capsule that you have here, this model Apollo capsule, also had lifting capabilities depending on the angle of attack, right, of the capsule. For instance, in this angle of attack, one would generate a lift force that would push the capsule up, whereas in this angle of attack, one would generate a negative lift that would push the capsule down. So many of these vehicles have lifting capabilities. And these different lifting capabilities of the vehicles, they can lead to different trajectories. Well, at the end of the day, even if one precalculates the trajectories, the reentry trajectories, in practice, one always has an uncertainty in the landing footprint. And this landing footprint depends a lot on the lift to drag ratio. So one can control the size of this landing footprint by controlling the lift to drag ratio. And for instance, in the screen, you have one example. So here you have a trajectory, a reentry trajectory, and you have the size of the landing footprint as a function of the lift to drag coefficient. So the lift to drag ratio. So as the lift to drag ratio increases, for instance, from 0.5 to 2.0, one can have a very large landing footprints, in the sense that one could land anywhere within that footprint. Well, that control also brings uncertainties into the problem, because if for whatever reason this lift force or this drag force is not correctly captured in the predictions, one is going to have a landing point that is going to differ from, is going to strongly differ from the real landing zone of a spacecraft. This, for instance, has happened already many times in the space program. So examples, for instance, of deviations from the predicted landing trajectory were in the Big Joe 1 mission that used a model or a boilerplate of the Mercury. This was the first mission Mercury, the first mission of the Mercury capsule that was unmanned. In this Big Joe 1 mission, there was an error of 500 miles in the landing zone. So the capsule actually landed 500 miles away from the predicted landing zone. It also happened, for instance, in the Gemini 1, the first Gemini mission that was crewed by Grissom and Young. In the Gemini mission, there was an error of about 60 miles in the landing zone. And it also happened in the two first Apollo missions, the suborbital missions, the ES-201 that had a 200 miles error, and the AS-202, also suborbital, that had an error of about 38 miles. So this is to say that depending on how these drag coefficients are predicted, one can have very large errors in the landing zone or not. So these uncertainties that you see here also motivated plenty of research during the 50s and the 60s on wind tunnel experiments to predict drag forces and lift forces. And along with those experiments were also theories, like the Newtonian theory that we described in the last discussion. So that research, for instance, led to results like this. This is the pressure distribution over the surface of a model of the Apollo capsule, like, for instance, this one, a little bit smaller than this one. So this one, right? So then measuring how one would measure the pressure distribution on the forebody of this capsule. So there in that slide, you have the results of those measurements for zero angle of attack. That was done by Jones at NASA Langley. So if you look at the screen, there those experimental data points are compared against the Newtonian theory, showing that the, in this case, the modified Newtonian theory was working reasonably well compared to the experiments. There were also other motivations to investigate at the beginning lift and drag coefficients coming from the Inviscid theory, and it wasn't related to the space program. It was related to the recovery of photographic films from surveillance satellites. So one of the first satellites was called Corona. And this satellite was launched by the United States right after the first satellite Explorer 1 was launched in the 1958. And this Corona satellite was had the mission of surveilling the Soviet Union and taking pictures of the Soviet Union. So the problem with this photographic film captured by Corona is that it had to be somehow retrieved. So here in the slide, for instance, you have a sketch of how it was retrieved. So the satellite would orbit, right? And then would take pictures. And then the satellite would have a re-entry vehicle in the nose that would take the photographic film and would re-enter the atmosphere. And the ground forces would have to recover the re-entry vehicle and the photographic film before anybody else took care of it. And this, for instance, was was a problem in the Corona program, because the second Corona satellite was predicted to land in Hawaii, and then it landed in a Norwegian island. And it turned out that the inhabitants of that Norwegian island were Russians. So the photographic film of this second Corona mission was never recovered. And it was also because of the errors in the prediction of the landing zone. And nowadays, the problem continues. It continues in defense systems, of course, in the development of missiles, but it also continues in the space program, in this case, in the prediction of the landing zone, for instance, on the Martian surface. So there on the screen, you have ellipses, landing ellipses predicted by calculations on the Martian surface. And these landing ellipses on the Martian surface, they tend to have diameters of the order of 20 kilometers. So as you can imagine, having an error on the surface of this planet, on the surface of Earth, of 20 kilometers is not a problem, because even in the worst case scenario, one could even hike to another place, right? Or be transported to another place within those 20 kilometers of error. But on the Martian surface, having a landing error zone of 20 kilometers, that's critical, because going from one place to another on the surface of Mars is not that trivial, right? For instance, in terms of oxygen supply and fuel supply. Well, so in the last lecture, we saw different methods for computing drag coefficients. And we saw, for instance, methods related to the Newtonian theory. And we saw that if you have a plate like that, and here is the inclination angle of the plate, and here there is a stream, density rho infinity, velocity u infinity, and pressure p infinity, then this stream is gonna get deflected by this plate according to the Newton theory by this angle delta, and then the velocity is going to go like u infinity multiplied by the cosine of delta, tangential to the plate. And then if one does here the force balance, then the pressure coefficient will go as twice multiplied by the sine squared of delta. Well, we saw, for instance, that one could calculate using the Newtonian theory problems like the drag force on the on a wedge, like what you have there, using both the Rankine-Hugoniot equations and then the Newtonian theory. And the Newtonian theory will give results within 20% error. One could also do the same exercise using a cone. And for the cone, the error of the Newtonian theory is much less. And we will see in this discussion why is it much less. Well, we also talk about possible shortcomings of this theory. And one of them was related to the fact that if one has a blunt body, then there's going to be a bow shock developing upstream from the body. And then the post-shock pressure, right, is going to be whatever static pressure is imposed by this Mach number. Here, close to the surface, the flow resembles a stagnation point flow. And as a result, the flow is going to be decelerated. And it's going to be decelerated partially isentropically. But the pressure close to the surface of the body is going to resemble the post-shock stagnation pressure. And it turns out to be that the pressure predicted by the Newtonian theory is actually larger, and is actually of the order of P infinity plus rho infinity U infinity squared. So we saw that, for instance, this disparity gives rise to an error in the prediction of the drag force when using the standard Newtonian theory. So the standard Newtonian theory would predict a drag coefficient of 1, right? Which is within 10% error of the measurements. So one could correct the Newtonian theory here using the modified Newtonian theory. And this was proposed by Lester Lees in 1955. And then the modified pressure coefficient will be a Cp maximum multiplied by the sine squared of delta, where this Cp maximum happens to tend asymptotically to 1.84 for a diatomic calorically perfect gas at high Mach numbers. So this factor here of 1.84 is smaller than 2, and as a result, one brings down the prediction of the drag coefficient, and the theory turns out to work well. Well, there is yet another modification that was proposed over the years, and this one was due to Busemann. In 1933. So Adolf Busemann was a German aerodynamicist. He worked at the Brunswick Research Center in aerodynamics. And then after the war, after the Second World War, he was brought here to the United States, also as part of the Operation Paperclip. And then he worked for many years at NASA Langley. Also, Busemann proposed that if one has a curved surface like this, this curved surface, the curvature, right? And then one has here a stream. Well, and let's say that this is the shock layer. And then this curvature, curved surface has a radius of curvature of equal to r. Well, there's going to be here an inclination angle, same as always, of delta. Well, he said that due to this curvature, right, there is going to be a radial pressure gradient developing, right? And this radial pressure gradient is going to have to balance with the centrifugal force. Here S will be the tangential velocity, you sabes. So this centrifugal force, what it's going to do is to generate a positive pressure gradient, in the sense that the pressure here at the edge of the shock layer, that for instance will be calculated by the Newtonian theory, this pressure is going to be actually larger than the pressure felt at the surface. And that's just because of this centrifugal effect. So Newton will be actually over predicting the drag over a curved surface. So then Busemann, he proposed that the after some analysis, right, one has to come here and apply trigonometry and also equilibrium of forces. In the interest of time, I'm just going to give you the result, and it is that the pressure coefficient proposed by Busemann was just twice multiplied by the sine squared of delta. This is the Newtonian pressure coefficient, and here minus a correction raised 2 divided by the radius of curvature and multiplied by this integral from 0 to y of the cosine of delta with respect to y. Y here is just a coordinate measured from the symmetry axis that measures the, let's say, the altitude of the point where we are looking at. Well, this was the correction, this was the modified Newtonian pressure coefficient that he proposed, with this 2 over r being proportional to the curvature, right? So, and this is the term that depends on the, that is brought here by the centrifugal effect. So it is not difficult for you to show that for a sphere, right, if one has a sphere like this, and this is the angle theta, like we were concerned about in the last discussion, for this sphere, the pressure coefficient will become 2 multiplied by the cosine squared of theta minus the sine squared of theta. So here theta is the latitude angle, it's not the inclination angle, and that is why one has to use here the cosine, not the sine. But this correction here is actually a centrifugal correction that what it does is to decrease the pressure coefficient on the flanks of this sphere, on the poles of the sphere. And that lowers the drag. Well, it turns out to be that this correction of Busemann actually didn't work that well. So you can see this in the slide. So this picture, a figure taken from Eggers in 1953 that was refurbished by Anderson in 2006. And this, in this plot, you can see the pressure coefficient over a biconvex airfoil that is plotted there in the sketch. And then this pressure coefficient is shown as a function of the streamwise distance divided by the chord of the airfoil. And you can see that the Inviscid numerical solution is in a dark solid line, right? The Newtonian, the straight Newtonian theory is in dashed lines, and the Newtonian Busemann correction actually goes in the opposite direction, opposite to the numerical solution, right? So that was kind of surprising that the Newton-Busemann correction was going in the opposite direction. So that is to say that this Newton-Busemann correction tends to degrade the solution with respect to the Inviscid numerical solution at gamma 1.4. So most surprisingly is that if one performs a calculation instead of using gamma 1.4, for the Inviscid numerical solution, one uses a value of gamma close to 1, then surprisingly the results satisfy or compare very well with the Newton-Busemann correction. So this is to say the following: by bringing the Busemann correction into the Newton theory, one is supposed to add more fidelity in the estimate. But if one compares those estimates with an Inviscid numerical calculation using gamma 1.4, then one goes in the opposite direction. However, if one takes the Inviscid numerical solution and computes with a value of gamma close to 1, then everything tends to work well. So the question is, what is going on with this gamma variation? Why is it that gamma close to 1 is a better representation of the Newtonian theory? Or vice versa, why is that the Newtonian theory is a good representation of the Inviscid numerical solution close to, for values of gamma close to 1? You can see more examples that we will show later related to the to a wedge and to a cone, and you will also see that the Newton approximation resembles the Inviscid numerical solution at values close to, for gamma values close to 1. So this brings us to the following question: what is special here about the combined limit of large Mach numbers and gamma tending to 1? Why should we care about this limit? Well, in order to do this, let me just recall here that are high Mach numbers, the ranking Hugoniot jump conditions, they can be written in this limit. The pressure jump can be written as twice gamma divided by gamma plus 1 multiplied by Mach 1 squared multiplied by the sine squared of beta. Then the density ratio can be expressed as gamma plus 1 divided by gamma minus 1. The velocity ratio can be expressed as gamma minus 1 divided by gamma plus 1. The temperature ratio can be expressed as P2 over P1 multiplied by rho 1 over rho 2. So this is going to be equal to 2 multiplied by gamma minus 1 and divided by gamma plus 1 squared multiplied by Mach 1 squared sine squared of beta. And also that the post-shock normal Mach number can be written as gamma minus 1 divided by 2 gamma. Well, these are relations that are valid at Mach 1 sine of beta much larger than 1. So this is the hypersonic limit of Rankine-Hugoniot jump conditions. So we also saw that there is a relation for this beta as a function of delta, and in this limit, in the hypersonic limit, this relation can be written as tangent of delta is equal to twice the cotangent of beta multiplied by the sine squared of beta divided by gamma plus 1 minus twice the sine squared of beta. Obviously, this relation does not depend on the Mach number, or high Mach numbers. This can also be rewritten. I show you too that this relation can also be rewritten and is equivalent to this other relation. The tangent of beta minus delta divided by the tangent of beta is equal to U2n divided by U1n, and this is equal to gamma minus 1 divided by gamma plus 1. I also showed you in one of the previous discussions that the pressure coefficient Cp at these high Mach numbers can be written as 4 divided by gamma plus 1 and multiplied by the sine squared of beta. So these relations that you see here, let's say, are the asymptotic limits of the relations defining an oblique shock for high Mach numbers, for high normal Mach numbers. Well, so one actually wonders here what happens with these relations when one takes the combined limit not only the Mach number is large, but gamma tends to 1. And in order to do that, let me just define a parameter here that is called epsilon. And this epsilon is going to be defined as gamma minus 1 divided by gamma plus 1. Well, this epsilon here can also be written as the density ratio. So the density ratio epsilon and this number here are the same. This equality here is only valid for calorically perfect gases. One thing to notice too here, right, is that this density ratio does not depend on the Mach number, right? And this velocity here does not depend on the Mach number, the velocity ratio. So we will emphasize this later. Now, one could rewrite these equations that you have here behind me, right? These equations here as a function of epsilon, and then take a limit of epsilon tending to 0. The limit epsilon tending to 0 is a limit in which gamma tends to 1. So the first thing that we would need to do would be to rewrite here this expression as a function of epsilon. Well, that can be done just by using this expression, and you would obtain the following. P2 over P1 would be equal to 2 multiplied by epsilon plus 1 multiplied by the Mach 1 squared sine squared of beta. So for the density ratio rho 2 over rho 1, this would be equal to 1 over epsilon. For the velocity ratio, would be equal to epsilon, and then for the temperature ratio, again is P2 over P1 multiplied by rho 1 over rho 2. This will be twice epsilon multiplied by epsilon plus 1 multiplied by Mach 1 squared sine squared of beta. Then for the pressure coefficient, if you rewrite the pressure coefficient here as a function of epsilon, then the resulting expression will be twice 1 minus epsilon multiplied by the sine squared of beta. And then here, for instance, if I take this expression and I rewrite it as a function of epsilon, it's trivial because this is just epsilon, right? So the tangent of the difference of the angles divided by the tangent of beta is going to be equal to epsilon. So these are the shock jump conditions written in terms of epsilon at high Mach numbers. Well, so before moving further, one other thing that one can do here is to try to obtain other quantities, like for instance the post-shock velocity. So in order for me to obtain the post-shock velocity, U2, right, this U2 is going to be equal to U2n divided by the sine of beta minus delta. Well, sine of beta minus delta is not the same as the tangent of beta minus delta, so I need an expression for the sine of beta minus delta. I think I will let you show that the sine of beta minus delta, because of trigonometry, is equal to the tangent of beta minus delta divided by the square root of 1 plus the tangent square of beta minus delta. And then if I replace here, if I substitute this expression here, the beta delta relation, then I can express the sine of beta minus delta as epsilon multiplied by the tangent of beta and divided by the square root of 1 plus the epsilon square multiplied by the tangent square of beta. So I can insert this definition of sine of beta minus delta into this equation, and then I will have that is equal to U to n, which I'm going to actually use here a ratio in. I'm going to try to express this velocity U2 as a function of U1. So here I could write it as U to n divided by U1n multiplied by U1n, multiplied by, divided by U1, multiplied by U1, and then divided by the sine of beta minus delta. So let me just continue this line here. U2n divided by U1n is equal to epsilon. U1n divided by the by U1 is equal to the sine of beta. Then this will be multiplied by U1, and then here I will have to have the sine of beta minus delta, which is equal to all of this. So all of this is it's just this expression, 1 plus epsilon squared multiplied by the tangent of beta, the square divided by epsilon tangent of beta. So this epsilon goes away with this epsilon. And then what I have is the that the velocity, post-shock velocity can be written as, here I could put this tangent of beta inside the square root. So this will be 1 over the tangent square of beta plus epsilon squared, and here with the square root. And I will have a sine of beta, and then here I will have a U1. So this will give me the post-shock velocity at high Mach numbers, right? Then I could do the same with the post-shock Mach number. So here I've forgotten to say that the Mach number, the normal Mach number that you have here, right, at high Mach numbers, the post-shock normal Mach number can also be written as a function of epsilon. So one can write the post-shock Mach number square as epsilon divided by 1 plus epsilon. So one could also obtain here an expression for the post-shock for the post-shock Mach number. So this post-shock Mach number is just MA to N, the normal component divided by the sine of beta minus delta. I have MA to N here, right, from this expression. So I just need to say that this is equal to the square root of epsilon divided by 1 plus epsilon. This will be the square root of this normal Mach number square. And then multiply by the inverse of the sine of beta minus delta that I can obtain again from this expression. So this will give me the square root of 1 plus epsilon square tangent square of beta divided by epsilon tangent of beta. So in other words, so I can operate here and say that this normal, this post-shock Mach number can be written as follows. 1 over epsilon multiplied by 1 plus epsilon, and then multiplied by this function here, 1 divided by the tangent square of beta plus epsilon square. Right, so this is the second important relation. These relations here are valid for any value of epsilon, but they are only valid for high Mach numbers, right? So I have pretty much everything. I have the post-shock Mach number, post-shock velocity, and I have all these quantities expressed as a function of epsilon. So actually nothing prevents me from taking the limit epsilon tending to zero now, But before doing that, let me just here make two comments. Well, the first comment is that you see that the density ratio rho 1 over rho 2 is like goes like epsilon. Or if you want me to write it the opposite way, rho 2 over rho 1 is just 1 over epsilon. If I take a non-slender body like this, this would be a wedge. Here is gonna write that it is non-slender in the sense that this angle delta is an order unity quantity. When I talk about order unity quantities in angles, I obviously mean that the angle is written in radians, right? So delta is going to be an order unity quantity, and then as a result, there's going to be a shock wave here emanating from the nose. This angle beta is going to be also an order unity quantity. Although beta and delta, they tend to be always close. So these are high Mach numbers, but high Mach numbers such that MA1 multiplied by the sine of beta is large. Well, so here in the post-shock gas, I'm going to have a deflection of the streamlines, the velocity U2, and that velocity U2 is given by the expression that we just derived, and a Mach number that is also given by the expression that we just derived. If I look at a slender body, this angle is delta. So now I'm talking about a slender hypersonic flow over a slender body. So then there's going to be also a shock wave here emanating. So this shock wave angle beta here in this limit, this slender limit, delta is a small number, and beta is going to be also a small number. In both situations, I'm looking at the nominal value of epsilon. This nominal value of epsilon, as you know, is close to 0.16 for a perfect diatomic gas. So I haven't taken the limit of epsilon going to zero yet. Well, here you're gonna have also a velocity, a post-shock velocity U2. It is interesting to see here, for instance, first from this expression, or let's say from this second expression here, right, or written in this way, that we recover a result that we already pointed out before, and is that for beta and delta small, for delta small, there is a solution of this problem that implies also small values of beta in such a way that the tangent of beta minus delta can be approximated as beta minus delta, and the tangent of beta can be approximated as beta. So as a result, beta minus delta divided by beta is approximately equal to epsilon, or written in another way, that beta goes like delta divided by 1 minus epsilon. So that will be the angle beta for a slender body. So in this case, for instance, beta will go like delta divided by 1 minus epsilon. Well, this post-shock velocity, one can also come to the expression for the post-shock velocity here, right? And recognize that if beta is a small number, then 1 over tangent square of beta is going to be more important than epsilon square, when epsilon square is exactly non-zero. So as a result, in the slender limit, one is going to be able to neglect this term here, and you will have the sine over the tangent square of beta, and that will give you a cosine of beta. So that is to say that here, the post-shock velocity U2, this post-shock velocity is going to go like U1 multiplied by the cosine of beta. the same reason, if one comes here to the expression of the Mach number, of the Poisson Mach number, this expression for the Poisson Mach number, again, this epsilon square is going to be negligible compared to the inverse of the tangent square of beta. And this ratio here is going to be mostly going as a Mach number that goes like the 1 over the square root of epsilon divided by 1 over the tangent of beta. So let's say that these are, this is the slender limit of the expressions that we have there. Of course, the pressure, the Poisson pressure is going to diverge with the Mach number, and the temperature is going to go like epsilon to the Mach number squared. And what is more important is that the density here, the post-shock density, rho 2 over rho 1, this ratio goes like 1 over epsilon that I was pointing out here above. So this is to say the following, and is that when the Mach number is large, such that the normal Mach number is also large, then the post-shock pressure, the post-shock density is uniform. So you see here, the post-shock density is actually gives you a constant value that is independent of the Mach number. Well, the constancy of this, the fact that this density ratio does not depend on the Mach number, has been sometimes exploited in the theory of inviscid hypersonic flows. Give you one example. So if one has a blunt body like this, and then there is a shock wave, a bow shock like this, the Mach number here is very large. Turns out to be that when the Mach number is very large, if the Mach number is so large that it is such that the normal Mach number is also large along the entire length of the shock wave, then the density downstream of the shock wave is always the same. And it's actually rho 1 divided by epsilon. So we have a post-shock gas with uniform density if the Mach number is sufficiently large such that the normal Mach number is everywhere large. Well, here you can see that I have a post-shock gas that has a uniform density, right? So this is sometimes called the incompressibility limit of hypersonic flows. And the fact that the post-shock gas is incompressible, right, because the density is uniform in the hypersonic limit, can actually be exploited analytically, for instance, by obtaining an expression for the stream function downstream of the shock. And that has been done in classical analysis by Probstein and Hayes. So it is sometimes kind of contradictory, right, for somebody who is not familiar with this type of flows to imagine or to envision tackling a post-shock gas emerging from a hypersonic flow as a constant density flow. So and the only reason for the constancy is that for calorically perfect gases, the post-shock density is a constant, independent of the Mach number, and tends to be uniform if the normal Mach number is sufficiently large. So this is just a curiosity to know about the theory of inviscid hypersonic flows. Well, another aspect to remember here before I go and I take the limit of epsilon tending to zero is that the fact that one has a slender body like this and one has a high Mach number here, in the sense that the normal Mach number is large, one needs to be careful because if one maintains this Mach number constant, right, and decreases the opening angle of this wedge, right? So that is to say that one makes this wedge increasingly more slender. So I'll go from, which is from there to something more slender, to something even more slender. Then we will have to go back to the chart. And for instance, look at one of those isolines that you have there, which are solutions of the beta-delta relation. So let's look, for instance, at Mach 10. So imagine that I take that isoline of Mach 10 and then I start decreasing delta, right? So I'm going to be moving on top of that curve. I'm going to go going down in the beta axis and moving along that curve. So you see there that the flow at Mach 10 up there where the circle is going to be a hypersonic flow. Generally not a hypersonic flow over a over a slender body. Actually, the body there is non-slender because delta is already large there. But then if delta is decreased at that constant Mach number, then I will transition from the red region, which is representative of hypersonic flows over non-slender body, into that dark blue region close to the origin, where the flow is still hypersonic, but now the body is slender, right? Then I would transition into this scenario here on the board. And then if I keep on decreasing delta, one of the things that you see in the chart is that if one keeps on decreasing delta, one goes from that dark blue region into the gold color region and into the green color region. Those are representative of supersonic flows. Those are not hypersonic flows anymore, even though the Mach number is still 10. And it is because of the following. So one comes here and starts decreasing the opening angle, the wedge angle here. There is a point in which the condition Mach 1 multiplied by the sine of beta, which remember that in hypersonics, since beta and delta are similar, is also Mach 1 multiplied by the sine of delta. There is a point in which this condition, that the normal Mach number needs to be large, cannot be satisfied anymore. So if one starts narrowing down, starts making this body more slender and slender, then the sine of delta is going to start decreasing and decreasing. So there is a point in which the normal Mach number is no longer large. So one would end up with a supersonic flow instead of a hypersonic flow over a slender body. The body will be very slender, and then there will be a shockwave emanating from the nose that would not be close to the surface anymore. And in particular, it will be at an angle here given by the Mach angle. This Mach angle, as you know, is just the arc sine of 1 over Mach number. So in particular, you can see from this equality that in this situation, the normal Mach number is actually equal to 1, because from the definition of the Mach angle, the Mach angle renders normal unity Mach numbers. So this is to say that if in a hypersonic flow, even at high Mach numbers, one starts making the body more and more slender, one would end up with a supersonic flow instead of a hypersonic flow. Well, coming back here to the analysis, so now we have all these expressions, right? So let me just look at the at how these expressions collapse when one takes the limit of epsilon tending to zero. So for instance, if I go here, right, or epsilon tending to zero now, it is true that even if the body is non-slender, right, if I look at this expression for the beta delta relation, if epsilon tends to zero, then necessarily beta minus delta, the tangent of beta minus delta is going to tend to zero too. So beta and delta are going to be similar. So here I'm going to have again a shockwave, but this time the shockwave is going to be very close to the surface. Very, very close. So in particular, beta is going to be of the order of delta. To be very similar to delta. The same here, right? And if I look at the post-shock velocity, if I look here at this post-shock velocity in the limit of epsilon tending to zero, right? Then again, I'm going to have something that goes like the cosine of beta multiplied by U1. But since beta and delta are very similar, then this post-shock velocity goes like U1 multiplied by the cosine of delta. So this post-shock velocity here is going to go like U1 multiplied by the cosine of delta. This is actually surprising because in an earlier picture that I was drawing here in the Newtonian theory, I was emphasizing that the velocity impinges on the plate and then is deflected, and it's actually deflected exactly with this same value. Exactly with this same value. So here we have the first indication that both are equivalent. So the Mach number, the post-shock Mach number, if I came here to this expression, right, or to this one, these values that I quoted here are for small betas, right? So for small betas, the cosine of beta is 1, and this tangent of beta go just like beta. But for a non-slender body, this will go like 1 over the square root of epsilon divided by 1 over the tangent of beta. So as epsilon tends to 0, the post-shock Mach number becomes infinity. So this is to say also that in the Newtonian theory, the post-shock Mach number is infinity. Also, the density, the post-shock density here, is going to go to infinity. So in the Newtonian theory, necessarily when gamma tends to 1, or equivalently when epsilon goes to 0, the density that arises in the post-shock gas is actually infinity. And that is because the thickness of a shock layer goes to 0. So by continuity, the density there needs to go to infinity with a finite tangential velocity. Well, and also another important result is that if I come here to this expression for CP, then when epsilon tends to 0, this CP tends to twice sine square of beta. But it turns out to be that beta and delta are the same when epsilon tends to 0. So surprisingly, one comes here and actually recovers the Newtonian pressure coefficient. So in this scenario, right, one can prove that taking the ranking Hohenheim conditions and looking for the combined limit of epsilon tending to 0 and Mach tending to infinity renders a pressure coefficient, which is actually the pressure coefficient proposed by the Newtonian theory. Well, for the same reason, one could do here the same calculations and one would obtain that the pressure coefficient would go as a twice multiplied by delta squared for delta small, that would be for a slender body. Well, so here, right, we have already seen that the Newtonian theory and the Inviscid Ranking Hohenheim equations are actually equivalent when gamma tends to 1 or equivalently when epsilon tends to 0. So you can see, for instance, here also some of these results for a wedge. So if one takes a wedge and one sends the adiabatic coefficient from 1.4 to 1.05, one gets much closer to the Newtonian theory. Much, much closer. So the same, for instance, for a cone. One takes numerical solutions around a cone for gamma 1.4, and decreases the value of gamma to 1.05, then one obtains a value for the drag coefficient that is very close to the Newtonian theory. Well, before going into how to calculate those results that you had about the cone that I just showed you in the screen, let me also tell you the following. So, as you can see, in this analysis, epsilon depends crucially on the gamma, but it also depends generally on the density ratio. So why is this connection important, and why the limit of epsilon tending to 0 is actually important in practice? Because that's ultimately the reason why the Newtonian theory tends to work well. Well, it turns out to be that if one, for instance, looks at the equation of state, let's say equation of state for the post-shock gas, P2 will be equal to rho 2 multiplied by the gas constant and multiplied by the post-shock temperature. If one looks at this equation of state, then one realizes of the following. So here the pressure, the post-shock pressure, tends to be always imposed, as we were mentioning before, by the kinetic energy of the free stream gases. Then this density that you have here, right, is a density that reaches a constant value or a top value given by actually epsilon times rho 1 for a calorically perfect gas, with this epsilon being equal to gamma minus 1 divided by gamma plus 1. So let's say that the post-shock density in a calorically perfect gas cannot be arbitrarily high. So it needs to reach a top value. Sorry, this will be rho 1 divided by epsilon. A top value, this will be gamma plus 1, gamma minus 1, and here we have to multiply this by rho 1. a top value which is about 6 times rho 1. Cannot go above this. And then as a result, this temperature can also increase with the pressure. This pressure P2 increases like the Mach number squared. This temperature T2 increases like epsilon multiplied by Mach 1 squared. And this rho 2 goes like 1 over epsilon. So this is to say that if I limit the value of V rho 2, then an increase in pressure given by an increase in the Mach number needs to cause an increase in the temperature. Well, this increase in the temperature is actually unrealistic, as I was showing you in a previous discussion. And it is that, for instance, at Mach 25, one can obtain post-shock temperatures of the order of 30,000 kelvins. And the unrealisticness of the values of the post-shock temperature have to do with the constancy of V rho 2 regardless of the Mach number. Now, if one was able to obtain higher values of the density, then one could actually moderate the increase in temperature with the Mach number. And as a matter of fact, one could obtain realistic values of the post-shock Mach number. So this already tells us that in reality, the ratio rho 2 over rho 1 for a real or for a practical situation in which the gas is not calorically perfect is actually much larger than 1 over epsilon. It's actually much larger than this calorically perfect limit. One can actually reach in situations in which the gas is vibrationally excited, and in situations in which the gas is also dissociating, density ratios that are much higher than 6. One can reach, for instance, density ratios of order 20. And as a result, one would obtain temperatures, post-shock temperatures, that would be realistic. So this is a problem. The problem that the density can only reach, the post-shock density can only reach to 6 times the pre-shock density, is a problem of the calorically perfect gas theory that leads to unrealistic temperatures. Now, in general, right, we saw that there is an equation that is the Rankine, that is actually the combination of the Rayleigh line and the Hugoniot curve, the second, the Hugoniot curve for a general gas. I'm not going to assume here any calorically perfect gas, so this is valid for even for a dissociating gas. The Hugoniot curve can be written as H2 minus H1 equal to P2 minus P1 divided by 2 and multiplied by 1 over rho 2 plus 1 over rho 1. So this is a general equation. As I said, this is not only for calorically perfect gases, but it can be also for gases that are vibrationally excited or for gases that are dissociating. So here I could express this as a function of epsilon by taking rho 2 and as a common factor and saying that this P2 minus P1 divided by 2 rho 2. And here 1 over epsilon plus 1. Well, if I rearrange this equation, then this will give me epsilon will be equal to P2 minus P1 divided by rho by 2, H2 minus H1 minus P2 minus P1. This will be 2 rho 2. Then if I take here the hypersonic limit of high Mach numbers, then the post-shock pressure is always larger than much larger than the pre-shock pressure. The post-shock enthalpy is going to be much larger than the pre-shock enthalpy, and as a result, this expression goes like P2 divided by rho 2 divided by twice H2 minus P2 over rho 2. I could also make use here of the definition of the internal energy or the enthalpy as H equal to internal energy plus P over rho, and re-express this denominator as a function of internal energy. So this is going to be equal to P2 over rho 2 divided by H2 plus E2. So here I have obtained an expression for epsilon, which is general. In general, it does not depend on the type of gas that I'm looking at. So it's just based on the Rankine on the Hugoniot curve. So it is important to examine this expression because when For instance, the gas is vibrationally excited. One of the things that happen is that this P2 over rho 2 that I can express like this is equal to the gas constant multiplied by T2. When the gas is vibrationally excited, then this temperature is going to decrease. And that is because there is a portion of internal energy that has to be dedicated to excite the vibrational degrees of freedom. So this T2 is going to decrease. So that means that this entire numerator is going to decrease when the gas is vibrationally excited. Then also, when the gas is vibrationally excited, there is going to be here an additional contribution to this internal energy that goes into vibrational internal energy. As a result, this E2 here is going to increase. This E2 here is going to increase. So the numerator decreases, this E2 increases when the gas is vibrationally excited. So that means that this epsilon, this density ratio, is actually going to decrease when the gas is vibrationally excited. Also, when the gas is dissociating, this enthalpy here, the post-shock enthalpy, since the dissociation is a process that is endothermic in the net, this post-shock enthalpy is going to increase. So the post-shock enthalpy, now when the gas is dissociating, has a component, which is a thermal component. It depends on the CP, on the specific heats, and the composition of the mixture. But it also has a chemical component. And this chemical component, when the gas is dissociating, is actually positive. So as a matter of fact, when the gas is dissociating, this H2 is going to increase too. So we have compounded effects here. So as the temperature increases and the degrees of freedom, the vibrational degrees of freedom of the gas are excited, the numerator decreases, the internal energy is going to increase. As a result, epsilon is going to decrease. And when the gas is dissociating, the enthalpy is going to increase. And as a result, epsilon is going to decrease. So that is to say that all the physical processes that are the culprit in hypersonics, all those thermochemical processes, they push epsilon towards smaller values. In other words, they push epsilon to the Newtonian limit. And that's probably ultimately the reason why the Newtonian limit is practically relevant limit. So, well, as I showed you in this chart, right, one can calculate solutions for a cone, right, using a specific theory that is called the Taylor-Maccoll theory. So I'm going to develop it here. Let's consider now a hypersonic flow over a cone. Well, cones are very important geometries for a variety of, for a number of different engineering applications. So, let's investigate what happens when one has an inviscid hypersonic flow over a cone. So here, let me just draw a cone. This is going to be a sharp cone that is going to have an apex semi-angle equal to delta. So here the Mach number is going to be large. So as a result, I'm going to have a shockwave, an oblique shock emanating from the vertex of the cone, and the shock angle here, shock incidence angle, is going to be beta. Well, the flow over this cone differs fundamentally from the flow over a two-dimensional wedge. And the reason is the following. So if one looks here at the streamlines, we just plot this in red. For instance, two streamlines. These streamlines are going to be deflected by the shock. And they're going to be deflected at some angle that I'm going to call here delta prime, with delta prime in general being different from delta. Well, because of the three-dimensionality of this flow, it is only until later downstream where these streamlines, they become parallel to the surface of the cone. Let me extend the cone and make it longer for illustration purposes. Then later, these streamlines, they become parallel to the surface of the cone, and now their inclination angle is actually delta, the same as the opening angle of the cone. In general, this delta prime is smaller than delta. So that is to say that the streamline deflection angle right downstream of the shock is smaller than the opening angle of delta. So in here, in these streamlines, one thing that one can see is that this cross-section of the streamlines is actually decreasing. So in other words, these streamlines, they converge downstream of the shock. So the situation is similar to a situation, for instance, of a supersonic diffuser. So supersonic diffuser, something like this, where you have a supersonic flow, and then the cross section is decreasing, right? So if the cross section decreases in a supersonic flow, what happens is that the Mach number is going to decrease, right? The velocity is going to decrease, the pressure and the temperature are going to increase. So this is called a supersonic diffuser. The same happens here. This cone behaves as a supersonic diffuser. The delta prime is in general different from delta, and in particular is smaller than that delta. What it means is that if you think about it, this oblique shock is the solution of the beta-delta relation, but written not in terms of delta, but in terms of delta prime, because the Rankine-Huener conditions are always valid here. The problem is that they are not written in terms of delta. They're going to have to be written in terms of delta prime. The fact that it takes longer to the stream to adapt to this angle delta, this semi-angle delta of the cone, means that right downstream of the shock, the streamline deflection angle is smaller than delta. So this is to say that the beta corresponding to this delta prime is also smaller than the beta corresponding to this delta. And as a result, the shock is closer, is relatively closer to the cone than to the wedge. So if I were to take the same problem and solve it with a wedge, the shock incidence angle that I would obtain would be larger than the shock incidence angle that I would obtain for a cone. And it has to do with this delay on the deflection. And since we saw that the Newtonian theory works well when the shock and the surface are mostly the same, it is no surprise that the Newtonian theory works better for a cone, and it is because the shock around a cone is closer to the surface than the shock over a wedge at the same Mach number, and it is because of this three-dimensional effect. Well, the cones, right, as I said, in engineering applications are important. For instance, one important engineering application is the engine inlet spike of SR-71 that you can see there as pretty sharp, and it has a vertex It's actually made of titanium. Although these flows over cones, they are different from the flows over a wedge, they also share commonality. So for instance, one example here is that if one plots here the beta delta relation for a wedge, the beta delta relation, that's something like this, right? So at a given Mach number, there is a maximum streamline deflection angle that one can have. And beyond that streamline deflection angle, then the shock becomes detached. That is for a wedge. Well, for a cone happens more or less the same. So here you have pictures of this projectile. It's a 2-pounder projectile, an anti-tank projectile with a 40 degrees apex. And these are pictures taken from the paper of Maccoll in 1936. So here the Mach number is 1.74. So what Maccoll did was to keep this shape of the projectile constant, right? And start decreasing the Mach number. So this is to say that if one takes here a constant value of delta, whatever value of delta, then decreasing the, as one decreases the Mach number, right, there is going to be a point in which one is not going to find any solution of the problem, and therefore the shock will be detached. As you can see here, one goes from Mach 1.74, starts decreasing the Mach number, 1.57, the shock angle varies, then the Mach number is further decreased at 1.32. The shock here is about to separate. And finally, 1.09. So there you can see a scenario in which the shock has detached from the projectile. Well, so Maccoll used these pictures, right, to obtain a theory. And he worked together with G.A. Taylor, who you can see here that he's actually watching us. So he worked together with G.A. Taylor. Maccoll was in the Royal Armament Research and Development Establishment in the United Kingdom. So Maccoll was first a ballistics officer, and then he became a superintendent. And then he engaged G.A. Taylor, who was also British, to obtain a theory for the pictures that you just saw there. So then both together came up with a theory that was called the Taylor-Maccoll theory. Which we're going to develop here. Well, this theory, right, is based on the following. I will show you later that when one has a shock wave that is straight, so it doesn't have any curvature, like for instance the one that one has here, it's a straight shock, then since the flow is also adiabatic, necessarily the post-shock flow needs to be irrotational, and that's called the Crocco theorem. Well, I'm not going to show that here explicitly, I'm going to do it in the next discussion, but the fact that the flow here downstream of a shock is irrotational already imposes a constraint in the problem, an important constraint. The second constraint too is that for a supersonic flow, supersonic inviscid flow, this problem that you have in front of you only depends on one coordinate. And that coordinate is this latitude angle theta. So in other words, there is a solution of the problem such that the velocity only depends on theta. The pressure only depends on theta. The temperature only depends on theta. And the density only depends on theta. They're all functions of theta. And here I'm going to define this radial coordinate R with two velocities. An azimuthal velocity V and a radial velocity here U. So these are going to be the two components of the velocity, U and V. So U goes in the radial direction and V goes into the theta direction. There is another coordinate here, right, which is related to the longitudinal angle. So in three dimensions and in spherical coordinates, so one has here the Z axis, here the X, and here the Y axis. So this is the cone, right? So one has also here theta. Well, so if one has here the radial coordinate R, there is another angle. There is another angle given by the coordinate X and the projection of the radial coordinate onto the XY plane. So this angle is the longitudinal angle phi. Since the flow is irrotational and the only relevant component of the vorticity here will be the vorticity in the phi direction, then the phi component of the vorticity is going to be equal to 1 over R multiplied by the partial derivative with respect to R of R multiplied by V minus the partial derivative of U with respect to theta. And that has to be equal to 0. Well, since V only depends on theta, does not depend on R, then this equation here basically tells me I can cancel the R, right, with that 0. So this equation here will tell me that V minus D U D theta is equal to 0. So I will obtain a first constraint that tells me that V is equal to D U D theta. Well, one can obtain a second constraint from continuity. By saying that in spherical coordinates, the continuity equation can be written as 1 over R squared multiplied by dVdr of rho multiplied by U multiplied by R squared plus 1 over R multiplied by the sine of theta multiplied by dV theta of rho multiplied by V and multiplied by the sine of theta. Equal to 0. Well, one can operate here, right? And for instance, here in the first part, since these two quantities only depend on theta, then this entire term here is going to give me twice multiplied by rho and multiplied by U and divided by R. And this is going to be equal to plus 1 multiplied by R sine of theta. And here I can expand this derivative and say that, for instance, in the first term is going to be rho multiplied by V multiplied by the cosine of theta. The second one is going to be V multiplied by V rho D theta multiplied by the sine of theta. And the last one is going to be plus rho multiplied by DV D theta multiplied by the sine of theta. So this is going to be equal to 0. And I can also here cancel the R's. And I can operate these two rho u. So here I'm going to have plus rho v multiplied by the cotangent of theta. Here the sine is going to cancel with the sine. So I have plus v multiplied by d rho d theta. the sign is going to cancel also with that sign. So I'm going to have plus rho dv dz is equal to 0. And then if I use here the fact that the flow is irrotational, if I use it here in the continuity equation, then I can replace v by u. And then I will obtain that 2 rho u plus rho multiplied by du d theta multiplied by the cotangent of theta plus d rho d theta multiplied by du d theta plus rho multiplied by the second derivative of u with respect to theta squared is equal to 0. And lastly, if I go and I divide everything by rho, right, I'm just going to do it here as manually, right, I'm just going to divide all of this by rho. So here I will cancel this rho goes away. Then here I will have 1 over rho. And then here this rho will go away. So this is what the combination of mass and irrotationality gives me. Remember that this condition of irrotational flow is actually the combination of momentum and energy, as I will show you later. But this will be the second relation. The problem in this relation is that there is a density, right? There is a density variation here. If this density variation was not there, then one could solve the problem for the velocity. But unfortunately, one needs to obtain an expression for the density variation. In order to obtain an expression for the density variation, one can come here and apply the following constraint. Well, so here, since the shock is straight, right, all the flow that it is downstream of the shock is actually traversing the shock, and the entropy of each streamline, right, is actually the same. So the entropy in the post-shock gas is uniform. So since the shock is straight and the flow is inviscid, then the flow, the post-shock flow, is actually homentropic. This is to say that the entropy is uniform there. We saw in one of the first discussions that if the flow is homentropic, then one can write a Bernoulli equation for the gas. And in particular, there will be the static enthalpy plus the kinetic energy squared divided by 2. So the static enthalpy plus the kinetic energy per unit mass is going to be equal to the stagnation enthalpy. This stagnation enthalpy is the stagnation enthalpy of the post-shock gas, but it's the same as the pre-shock gas. So one can rewrite this expression, right? This stagnation enthalpy does not depend on the streamline because, as I said, the flow is isentropic. So one can rewrite this expression in terms of the pressure and the density just by saying that the enthalpy here is equal to Cp multiplied by T, and this is equal to gamma divided by gamma minus 1 multiplied by P and divided by rho. So as a matter of fact, if one rewrites this expression, is equal to gamma multiplied by P2, for instance, for the gas downstream of the shock, that will be gamma multiplied by P divided by gamma minus 1 divided by rho. Here it will be U squared plus V squared divided by 2, and here we will have gamma multiplied by PO2 divided by gamma minus 1 and divided by rho 2. So this PO2 and this rho 0.2, they're actually stagnation values of the pressure and the density downstream of a shock, and they are uniform because the flow is homentropic there. Well, so since the flow is homentropic there, one can also relate any two points of the flow through an adiabatic. So this is to say that the curve relating pressure and density over any trajectory here in the post-shock gas, since the flow is homentropic, well, it follows a trajectory, a thermodynamic trajectory that corresponds to a constant entropy trajectory. So this trajectory is P over rho to the gamma is equal to PO2 divided by rho 2 to the gamma. Well, so one can actually operate here, right? one could obtain the density, could substitute the pressure into this relation, right, and obtain a expression of the density as a function of the velocity. And by combining these two expressions, one would obtain that the density divided by rho 2 to gamma minus 1 is equal to 1 minus u squared plus v squared divided by a characteristic velocity squared. This v0 squared is a characteristic velocity of the problem that appears. This expression here gives me the density as a function of the velocity everywhere in the Posokas, and this characteristic velocity v0 squared is a velocity that is given by the square root of 2 divided by gamma minus 1 and multiplied by the stagnation speed of sound in the Posokas square. This velocity here is something that also emerges in the analysis of convergent divergent nozzles. So this is, for instance, the maximum velocity that can be achieved by expanding a gas against vacuum. So in a convergent divergent nozzle, if one has a pressure ratio from the environment to this reservoir, for instance, up here upstream, PO2, if one sends this atmospheric pressure to a vacuum, then the velocity that would one obtain at the exit would be this characteristic velocity v0. That would be the velocity of expansion against vacuum. So that's a characteristic velocity that appears here. Well, one could also differentiate this density, right? This could also differentiate this expression and obtain an expression for the d rho d theta, right? And then with this expression for d rho d theta, one could come here, right, to this constraint and substitute it here. That would basically close the problem. The solution of the problem can be written in the following manner. So V2 multiplied by U plus the cotangent of theta multiplied by du d theta plus d second U d theta squared multiplied by gamma minus 1 multiplied by 1 minus 1 over V0 squared, then multiplied by U squared plus du d theta squared. This will be equal to twice V0 squared multiplied by du d theta squared and multiplied by u plus v second u d theta. So this will be the differential equation that would describe the flow over a cone, right? And this is just a function of u. It can be written autonomously for, can be solved autonomously for u. Well, this equation is also subject to boundary conditions, and in particular, two boundary conditions. One will be a boundary condition on the surface of the cone, theta equals to delta. Theta equals to delta, there has to be a non-penetration boundary condition on the surface of the cone. So that is to say that a theta equals to delta, v has to be equal to zero, or equivalently, the theta derivative of u has to be equal to zero. And then there is an additional boundary condition that needs to be applied on the shock at beta. And at the shock, at theta equals to beta, the remember I have here my two components, my radial component and then my azimuthal component. Well, the azimuthal component of the velocity needs to be equal to minus the post-shock normal velocity. So I can rewrite this as minus u2n divided by u1n and multiply by U1 and multiply by the sine of beta. So let's do it slowly. U1n multiplied by U1n divided by U1 and multiplied by U1. So this will be minus U2n divided by U1n multiplied by the sine of beta and multiplied by U1. So this will be the boundary condition for V, which is also equivalent to the theta derivative of U. So that will give me another constraint for the derivative of U. This coefficient here is a coefficient that depends on the Mach number and on beta. Then there is a third boundary condition that is needed here, and this third boundary condition involves the radial velocity of the shock. The radial velocity of the shock is going to be equal to the tangential velocity by construction of the post-shock axis. Then this tangential velocity, because of the continuity of tangential momentum, is going to be equal to the pre-shock tangential velocity. And this is going to be equal to U1 multiplied by the cosine of beta. Well, these boundary conditions that you have here, this first one, the second one, and this third one, they basically close the problem. Notice that in this problem, beta is unknown. So beta actually is an eigenvalue of the problem. This is a free boundary value problem and needs to be solved iteratively. So first assuming a value of beta, then computing the solution and checking that the boundary conditions are satisfied, and so on and so forth. Well, so given the Mach number, this problem, and given the Mach number and given delta, those are all the parameters that one needs in the problem. So let me just show you some solutions here. So for instance, these contours that you have in the screen are the post-shock Mach number contours for a cone of 20 degrees semi-angle at Mach 3. So you can see that the Mach number is high right after the shock, but because of the compression produced by the cone, then the Mach number decreases close to the surface. Then the same can be seen, for instance, for the contours of the pressure. So this is again the same cone of a semi-angle 20 degrees at Mach 3, and then because of the compression effect of the shock, then the pressure, the static pressure, is increasing from the shock to the surface of the cone. So you can see some more plots here. This is a cone flying at Mach 7 in the stratosphere. So here you can see on the left the distribution of local pressure as a function of the latitude angle going from the surface to the shock wave. And on the right you can see the local temperature for the same cone, also as a function of the latitude angle ranging from the surface to the shock. So this is already a Mach 7. So if one looks at the contours, for instance, of Mach 10, then the shock wave is very close to the surface of the cone. And if one, instead of computing with gamma 1.4, one computes with 1.05, then the shock is even closer to the surface of the cone, thereby highlighting that this limit is pretty much equivalent to the Newtonian limit. Well, this is these exercises are for supersonic and hypersonic cones. So in the next discussion, we're going to talk about blunt bodies, which are technologically relevant for a number of applications.